Okay, hello everyone. I am here with Kean and Lorenzo from Autodesk today. And where are we at?
Oh, Las Vegas. We're at Autodesk University 2018.
That was a tricky question.
I'm sorry. So maybe I'll introduce you. You have been working for Autodesk for 23 years?
23 years.
That's amazing.
Short years.
Yeah. So what is it exactly that you do?
So for the last 3 years or so, I've been in the Autodesk research team, and I focus on two main areas of research, one being the integration of IoT data into a building model, into or a 3D context generally for visualization. And the other one is on the generative design side. So I work closely with my friend Lorenzo here on that.
It's my turn.
Please.
My name is Lorenzo. Yes. I am an architect and research scientist with The Living. Mm-hmm. The Living is a first of its kind Autodesk studio. Oh. It's an architecture and research studio that was acquired, was an independent architecture studio that was acquired in 2014 and we are formally owned by Autodesk and part of Autodesk Research. My focus is on computational design and generative design.
Very cool. Mm-hmm. So the reason I grabbed those two to sit down with me is because I heard a presentation by them about generative urban design, and I thought that was really cool, so I wanted to share that with you and ask them a few questions, if that is okay.
Absolutely.
So can you briefly explain the concept of generative urban design?
Sure. More generally speaking, generative design is a form of co-design. Mm-hmm. So it involves combining on one side artificial intelligence and on the other side human creativity to create solutions to design problems that would otherwise not be possible, that humans alone would have not be able to create without the computer, and solutions that the computer alone would have not been able to create without humans.
Can you maybe give an example?
Sure. Another way that we describe it is instead of starting by drawing the shape or the form of what you want, you start with the goals and the constraints of the problem, and then you task the computer with the automatic generation, evaluation, and evolution of literally tens of thousands of high performance solutions.
Yes, so how are the steps, how does that work? So it starts with the architect and the engineer, right?
Yeah, with any professional that is interested in changing the way we're currently designing. So it could be an architect, a designer, or an engineer. Yeah. It's a framework, first of all, that can be applied to a very diverse set of design problems, but also across many different scales. Mm-hmm. So it could be applied all the way from a industrial component to architecture, so the scale of buildings, and all the way to the city.
Okay, and so what are the elements that are involved with that?
So there are three main steps.
Yes.
You start with the generation part, which is a parametric model that can create a vast solution space. So it design space of all possible solutions that that same model can create.
Okay.
Then there is the evaluation part in the form of design goals or simulation algorithms that can score numerically each design solution. And then the third component is evolution, so the optimization part. And this involves the use of an intelligent system that can learn how to improve each design solution over generation and over generation. Improve their performance.
Okay, so the way that the creative process works is that first the generation of tens of thousands of different designs, right? Mm-hmm. But just like randomly?
No, actually it's not random. It could start randomly. Mm-hmm. There are different ways to start the first generation, but soon after that, in our case we're using a genetic algorithm.
Okay.
Which is based on principles of evolution, Darwinian evolution. It picks the best high-performing solution of the first generation, and through this process of breeding, selection, and mutation, the best-performing solution survive to the next generation, and so on and so forth. You start like creating very strong and high-performing solutions over time. Yeah. So, which is totally different than random. If we were doing a totally random search of possible solutions, it would just take too long before finding something that is actually really good.
And then what happens in the optimization? If you say that the designs already evolved from generation to generation, what happens then with the...
Well, what happens afterwards is the human component comes in, in place. Well, the human component is always present throughout the process.
Okay.
But specifically at the end, once you have this large data set of design options, you can start navigating the design space and through custom analysis tools, identify the trade-off between each design solution along the design goals that you have pre-established at the beginning of the process.
Okay. Yeah. Well, maybe, Kean, you can tell me a bit more about the software that we can use in a workflow like this.
Sure, sure. So on Monday of this week, Autodesk actually launched a public beta of Refinery, which is an extension that you load into Dynamo, which is a visual programming tool.
Yeah.
That I'm sure your readers know about. But basically, you set up your graph inside Dynamo with inputs and outputs, marked as such, inputs and outputs. And Refinery can...
What would those inputs be, for example?
Oh, so it's just take, for example, I mean, one example I've been using is related to tiling a floor plan.
Yeah.
So one of the constraints of the system is the floor plan itself. And then the inputs could be the orientation of the tiles, and then maybe an offset in the X and Y distance, you know, directions.
Okay.
And then, so those three inputs, varying those inputs will, of course, change the outputs. And in this case, the outputs are the number of complete tiles, the number of partial tiles that have to be cut to fit within the boundary, and then maybe like the discarded area of tiles that you're throwing away.
Mm-hmm.
So then, based on those outputs, Refinery will load the inputs and the output. We'll load the graph, the inputs and the outputs.
Yeah.
And then you'll set up your generation run. And you can choose to do a completely random run where it randomizes the various inputs. You can choose a cross-product run, which is optioneering, which means that you're sort of systematically exploring the solution space or the parameter space by having sort of fixed offsets through the various parameters combined, you know, with the permutations.
Yeah.
Of those, and then it generates all these solutions, so it's very systematic. And then the third way of doing it is in my opinion the most interesting, which is of course this optimization run, which is using this genetic algorithm to hone in on some optimal solutions. So typically you'll then specify that you want to maximize the number of complete tiles and minimize the discarded area of tiles.
Yes.
And then it'll go ahead and run through and optimize those. It'll run the graph with various inputs that get tweaked each time in each generation based on the outputs.
So the example with the tiles would be something very simple that somebody could start with, right?
Yes, absolutely. So I mean, I've posted the graph for the tiling example on my blog, which sure will be added
I will put a link in the description.
So just go ahead and check it out, and then
can you
load
point down and then make it
click here to load click here to load the Dynamo script and here to load the floor plan.
Very well.
Okay. Does that work? Well,
I just wanted to do that.
And here you have another video. Subscribe.
Exactly.
No, but if you say this would be a small application, but tell us how large scale can you go with this?
So I mean, even the graph isn't completely trivial. I mean, there are some steps that you have to go through in order to do even a fairly simple problem like that. But you know, the project that Lorenzo and I have been working on for Van Wynen, which is at a different scale, which is the urban scale. So, to define the layout for a residential neighborhood, it's big. I mean, it is a big graph.
Okay.
But you don't have to go big to make use of it. So I suggest that people trying it out start small and sort of think about, you know, understand the system and how it works, and then gradually sort of scale up over time.
What would you say to somebody who says, well, a computer can never generate, like, replace the creative process of a human being?
So that's, I don't think that the goal is for this type of process to replace humans at all. I don't think that's the case. But what it does do is create insights that we as humans are sometimes kind of formatted not to explore.
Okay.
So it'll give us, it'll explore the space in a way that we won't necessarily do ourselves,
mm-hmm.
and generate solutions that inspire us to think about the problem differently,
okay.
as well. So I think that that's something that's fairly common with generative design. It's not necessarily creating a better solution than one that a human would do, but
mm-hmm.
I mean, it's certainly, you know, evaluated in a very
yeah.
numeric way, but it'll certainly give us insights that are outside the norms of what we would generally decide to do, because we tend to sort of work in a very structured, similar way
yeah.
over time. So I actually find that in some ways, I mean, it's not creative, but it's generating solutions that sometimes seem very creative,
okay.
because they're outside of what
we are used to,
yeah.
yeah.
So
yeah.
So that's very interesting. And then, of course, you can, you know, over time with these systems, we'll be factoring in machine learning and other ways which can sort of evaluate things that are somewhat quite subjective. Like, that's a very interesting thing about machine learning, is it very often they're able to do things that seem like they're creative and aesthetic in nature, whereas actually it's really just about analysis and numbers.
Okay.
And so those, the combination of genetic algorithms to search through a space along with machine learning to evaluate options very quickly, I think is going to be very powerful.
Okay.
And we're already starting to see some examples of those. Of
like?
That. Well, there's one example that I show. Well, there's a video that's on the Refinery site that shows talking about optimizing the wall to window ratio, I think, for a building.
Yeah.
And at the same time, there's actually a machine learning component to that, which is based on some data that was gathered through Autodesk Insight 360, I think it's called.
Okay.
And so that neural network evaluates or does a computational, you know, or replaces what would be a very complicated computation to do daylight analysis and energy
okay.
analysis based on data that, you know, that we'd acquired or that is, you know, grown over time.
Okay.
So that's one example where you can use this combination of machine learning with genetic algorithms. Yeah.
Do you have anything to add to that?
Yeah, like on top of the great observations that Kean mentioned, one important thing that we always want to stress is that this is not a cold-blooded optimization process.
Mm-hmm.
We are not exploiting optimization.
Okay.
For us, it's more about exploration. It's about opening up, unlock the
okay.
designer's creativity. So we generally also define it as a way to go beyond intuition or
mm-hmm.
rules of thumbs or knowledge that you have acquired through past experience, which is very important, but because of those biases that
yeah.
you have as a designer, you might not have thought about solving that specific problem in a total different way. And generative design, because of its nature, it's not biased
yeah.
in itself as a framework. Of course, it is biased in the moment there's a designer behind it, but that's a whole different conversation. But as a framework, it helps you free yourself up from your own biases.
Well, thank you very much for giving me those insights and sharing it with my viewers. I feel like you're losing your voice a little, so
I just have to cough a little bit, but I'll be fine.
Okay,
I've
so thank you very much too for like even straining your voice some more.
It's really our pleasure to be here and
well,
to talk.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for having us.
Yeah, enjoy the rest of your stay in Vegas.
You too?
I will, yeah.
I know you will.
Bye-bye.
Bye-bye. Just in case, if we can
yes.
add it at the end, follow us here. Follow us here. Yeah, I'm just giving you some
just in
options.
Case, yeah, you can, yeah.